I went off to college my freshman year, and I took chemistry, and I got a C. And I'm giving a talk tonight called Everybody Gets an A. The reason I'm giving this talk about how everybody gets an A is I continue to be haunted by that C that I got my freshman year of college. I stop and I think about what impact that C had on me. For one thing, I am not a podiatrist now. The reason is that even 30 years ago, if you didn't get A's in your freshman chemistry course, you did not go to medical school, so that was out. The bigger problem for me, though, was that that C broke me. I didn't know it at the time. I was just this struggling freshman, just trying to get by. I'd get a B here, I'd get a C there, and then it was time to go home, several thousand miles back to where I came from. And as I flew home on that plane, I had this great idea. I was going to transfer back to the local community college. I had it all set up. One morning, just after the New Year, my father, an Italian immigrant who was not to be messed with, leaned over and whispered in my ear at 6 o'clock in the morning, "You are going back." And I went back. Things did not get better. Not for a while. It wasn't until my senior year that I earned my first A in chemistry. Now, you might be thinking, wait, something's wrong here. This guy teaches chemistry. Shouldn't somebody who teaches chemistry in college have at least earned like a B in the course he's teaching? I stop sometimes and I ask myself what this insistence is on testing and on assigning grades. And I really can't figure it out that well. I guess there are some things we should be thinking about, like maybe it's a good way to give us a sense of how to motivate a student to do better, or maybe it's a good measure of the fact that they're progressing along the way. Maybe it's a way to figure out who our next Nobel Prize winners are going to be. None of those make a lot of sense to me. I stop and I think about the fact that when you are assigning grades, the way it works is something like this. I've got 500 students coming into my freshman chemistry course. We have enough data out there to know exactly what their grades are going to be from the very first moment they walk into class. It's not hard. It works this way. Are you from affluence? Did you go to a nice suburban high school with lots of AP and IB course opportunities? Did your parents enroll you in that Duke TIP SAT thing? When you did well, did you get pats on the back? When you did badly, did they give you hugs? Those people get A's in my classes. On the flip side, there are the kids who come from under-resourced environments. They're the kids who show up in a classroom in which the teacher teaching them never actually took that course that they're teaching. They go home hungry, and they try to study when they can't find any food, because that really happens in this country. And then they ask their dad whether they should go to college, and their father says, "Your brother went off to UT. He flunked out. Why on earth should you go there?" That's the kid who doesn't pass my course. That's the world that we live in right now. It's kind of strange that we've created such a thing and that we honor it. Because I think of all the other ways in which we try to enjoy living our lives. For example, if I want to get better at basketball, or at playing a video game. What do? I go outside in the driveway and I practice shooting, or I go down in the basement and I got my little console. Can you imagine if there was a teacher there standing behind you and when you missed a free throw said, C+. Or you're doing that first person shooter game and you missed the zombie, oh, that's a D. We joke about that, and yet in the thing that really matters most, the classroom, the place where you're supposed to learn to read and to write and do arithmetic and learn history and to learn all the things that really matter, that kind of obsessive need to look over our shoulders and constantly vet our ability to be successful is just what we expect. That's just how it works. Now, I think about how most people respond when they're constantly under the gun and about how odd it is that usually the people who are most happy to be under the gun are the ones who are winning. I imagine most of the people sitting in this room spent most of their time when they were in middle school winning. And you won, of course, because there were other kids in that room who had to lose so that you felt good about yourself. I bet you probably never thought about them and what they were feeling. And now you're sitting in here now. Congratulations, you made it here. Those kids who didn't make it came to work every day as a student. And we're told, it's okay, put in your 8 hours. It's normal to feel mediocre all day long, day after day after day, and year after year after year. Where did we come up with this? How did this become the attitude we use with students? Why are we surprised when so many students drop out of high school? Why are we so surprised when college graduation rates aren't anywhere near what they need to be? My opinion is, it's because what we do in that room with that student breaks them when it doesn't have to. Now, I'm not trying to get down on teachers. I understand how hard it is to teach. And I understand that going way back, it was really hard to come up with a better way to do it. After all, content knowledge pretty much resided in the brains of those who professed it. There wasn't all knowledge on the internet yet. If you wanted to learn something, it was what somebody said at you that you scribbled down, and maybe there was a bad course packet and a bad textbook, and that's what you got to learn from. But those days have changed. Technology has absolutely changed everything. These days, all knowledge is on the internet. And because all knowledge is on the internet, it means that when it is time for me to profess, maybe I don't need to do that anymore. Maybe I need to facilitate the learning that's going to take place. And it isn't even about the fact that all content knowledge is on the internet. That's not where the really big changes are coming. The big changes are coming because of the dissolution of the temporal and the spatial way in which we educate. There was a commercial on TV about a guy walking into a hotel saying, is there any entertainment around here? And they said, what about any movie you ever wanted to watch that was ever made anytime you want to watch it? Well, that's education now. That's what it can be. Once that happens, once those barriers break down, then suddenly we're not confronted by these rules of engagement with students that we don't know how to get around. Every one of you, including all of the A students, can remember the time that you had 3 tests in one day and got B's on them all, and it was just not fair. I mean, seriously. And you walked up to somebody like me and asked me to cut you some slack, and it was like, seriously? No. Or that phone call that comes letting you know that your grandmother has had a stroke. And if you don't answer it, you get an A. And if you do answer it, you get a C because you're all broken up. And that's the reason you don't go to medical school? What's happening now, if we do it right, is a fundamental change in the way we approach how it is that we engage a student with respect to their successes. It's already happening out there. I mean, this may sound ridiculous, but that's what video games do. You go buy a video game these days, and you take it home, and I don't care if you're 7 years old and you've never pushed a button, or whether you're 15 and you're a master shooter. The 15-year-old may take 5 days to fix it, to get it learned, and that 7-year-old may take 3 months, but they both end up winning. And the reason is pretty simple. Those people who sold that game want you to go back and buy the next one. Why on earth isn't that the way we educate? The day is coming soon enough when it's not that first-person shooter game that you're going to be buying at the store. It's that first-person 3-semester credit hour course in chemistry. No joke. I'm sure it's out there now. And back here on this campus, we're going to be asking the question, how are we going to compete? So that kid's sitting at home with his dad, and his dad says, you know, for $49.95, you can get an A in chemistry, or you can go off to that university there where if your grandmother has a stroke, you'll get a C. We've got to change our attitudes back on these bricks and mortar campuses, or we are not going to compete. For myself and my own course, 5 years ago, I changed. I started to have this sense that I had become the person who broke me 30 years ago. So I started walking into class on the first day and saying out loud to students, it is my job to make sure that every one of you who wants it will get an A in this course. And if you don't, it's on me. Because I've got all kinds of resources available to me now that I didn't have 25 years ago, or that my professor didn't have 30 years ago. Because I don't begrudge him what he had to do. He was just being what I was. But now everything I have is on the internet. All of my lectures, thousands of video clips, every test I've ever given, every worksheet I've ever given, massive online social engagement in all of these different environments where everything a student wants to learn, they can learn. And back in the classroom, I've decided that I'm not simply going to give a kid a bad grade and call it a day. For every kid in my classroom, I'm going to create a way to grade them that incentivizes them wanting to learn all the way to the end. Freshman chemistry is just each semester 100 learning objectives. I've got 500 kids. That's 50,000 things I've got to do well. That's all it is, actually 90% of them. And if I can get 90% of those 50,000 done, I can give out 500 A's. For me, most of it is about looking at that student and saying, for you, the smart kid in the class, what will make you work your butt off through the rest of the semester? For you, the kid that comes from an under-resourced background who's about to fail the first test, what can I do to make you hang in there so that you can ace the final and get an A in my course? These days, in this flipped classroom in which I teach, it's the most glorious place imaginable. I don't teach anymore. That's all done online. I motivate. I facilitate. That's what I am. I'm just like, what do you do for a living? I am a facilitating motivator. Because that is a far more effective way for me to go about doing my job. And it's great. I walk into class and I lean over and I whisper to the students, let me tell you how to scam a multiple choice test. Because there are ways to scam multiple choice tests. It's like a magician's trick. Why can't I just tell it to them so they can win too? How is it working? Well, 10 years ago, I'd have 100 A's in the class and 100 kids would be like I was and not pass. This last spring, I had 300 A's in my class of 500 students, and only a handful of kids didn't pass. And it was the hardest tests I had ever given. My students in my class grade 3 letter grades better than the test bank predicts they will, because they all work their butts off, because they all know that if they do that, that they will get their A's. Now, for those who think, oh, this is the end of higher education, I say, oh, no, not at all. The real reason you come to a residential campus is not to have somebody like me talk at you. The real reason you come is to experience, is to do experiential learning and service learning and to develop leadership skills and to do research and to become, what do they call that, an adult under the supervision of people who know how to do it well for these incredible minds that are coming along. So, I think to myself about the day that's coming when that C that I got becomes obsolete because everyone gets an A. Thank you.